Heads as we approach the study of God's Word. Heavenly Father, as we study Thy Holy Word today, we pray that the Holy Spirit will come to our hearts and take the Word of the living God with its omnipotent energy and will power, because it comes from the will of God Himself, and strengthen our wills and strengthen our determination to follow Thee fully in these last days of earth's history is our prayer in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Amen. I invite you to take your Bibles with me and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 17 and 18, one of our scripture passages for today. 2 Corinthians 6, 17 and 18. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Now this is a command from God. Come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean. I'll just leave it there, because the word thing is supplied by the King James translators. Touch not the unclean, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. So here is a distinct command. It occurs in a passage discussing not being unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Let's look up here in verse 14, which is the context. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? In heaven there will be no rebellion. Not one shred, not one hint, not one heart will incline in the slightest toward rebellion. That all has to be cured and taken out of us here in this world. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. This is often applied to marriage, but it's talking about every dimension of life. And what concord hath Christ with Belial? There is a great controversy. There is no neutral ground. Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? In fact, the rebellion of the infidel, the rebellion of the ungodly, should drive us to be even more dedicated to the Lord, more dedicated to Christ, and to His great cause in the great controversy. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, now this is based on what we've just read, come out from among them and be ye separate. The Lord wants a clear line of demarcation between the righteous and the unrighteous, between the godly and the ungodly. Saith the Lord, it's a command of the Lord, and touch not the unclean, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. This is the basis for being the sons and daughters of God. He wants us to be separate in a world of sin, in a world that is contaminated with the contagion of rebellion. A very great principle that lies at the foundation of the great controversy. Now let's turn to Psalms chapter 1, the very first psalm, which sets the stage for all of the psalms and lays down the categories and makes the definitions. The Bible loves to produce definitions. For instance, in Hebrews chapter 9, we have a mini dictionary in which the rest of the chapter rests upon the definition of terms. In theology, the definition of terms is extremely critical because it affects everything else. Blessed, and the word blessed in Hebrew carries weight. When you are blessed of God, it's a weighty thing. There are so many dimensions of fruitfulness and productivity and life that come with being blessed. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Now this is the very first stage. He walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Now how can a person walk in the counsel of the ungodly? Well, many people can pick up the counsel of the ungodly from the media. They can pick it up from watching videos, DVDs. They can pick it up from listening to talk show hosts. They can pick it up from listening to the news. They can pick it up from the pulpit. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners. He doesn't even like to be around where sinners are. He doesn't hang around with them. He doesn't put himself in their company. He makes the separation. Nor sitteth in the seat of a scornful. These are the mockers of God and His Word that are scornful of the power of the Word of God. These are scornful of the weight and power and significance of that is carried in the Word of God to our hearts. But his delight is in the Torah, the divine instruction, the law of the Lord. That includes the Ten Commandments, but it's talking about all of the divine instruction, Bible and spirit of prophecy. And in his law, his Torah, doth he meditate day and night. So it's his continual meditation. He's not preoccupied with the things of this world. He's not preoccupied with the media. He's not preoccupied with politics. He's not preoccupied with all of these things, though some of these things may impinge upon the issues of the kingdom of God and need to be addressed. His delight is in the Torah, the divine instruction of the Lord. And in his Torah, his divine instruction, doth he meditate day and night. His mind is filled with the Word, saturated with it. And the more you study it, the more you follow the principle of having the divine instruction work upon your heart, the more you thirst for it. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And you can never get enough of it. And you won't ever feel that you can get enough of it for eternity. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Though there's desolation all around, though there's devastation all around, this man is like a tree planted by the rivers of water. He walks, as it were, in a charmed existence, a charmed life, because he is surrounded by angels, and he has the presence of God in his heart. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. So notice the contrast. The godly are firm, fixed, powerful, fruitful, productive. The ungodly are like chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. When you choose to follow the way of the Lord, he knows that way, and he knows you. Now, this is one separation that we're talking about here. The godly and the ungodly. The godly man does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, doesn't stand in the way of sinners, doesn't sit in the seat of the scornful. There is a separation between godly and ungodly. Now let's look at another deeper dimension of the separation in John chapter 15 that Jesus addressed at the Last Supper. John chapter 15 and verse 18. Jesus is giving his disciples counsel now about what is coming. If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. Now, what was the world that hated Jesus? Jesus grew up, lived through his life in Palestine. He only went out very briefly to visit this Syrophoenician woman, but most all of his time was spent in the land of the chosen people of God, the people who have been called by God. And yet he spoke about the world hating him. So he's talking about a dimension of the world that has invaded the church here. If ye were of the world would love his own, but because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. And the word for world here is cosmos. It's the world that the prince of the power of the air rules over, that Satan rules over. And it can extend into the people of God, the professed people of God. So he noticed, here we have the contrast now, the separation between church and world, and world that is within the church. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. So the disciple is just like his master. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. And Jesus again and again told the Jews that they did not know him. They did not know him, nor did they know his Father who had sent him. If I had not come and spoken unto them, who did he speak to? The Jews, the professed people of God. They had not had sin, but now they have no cloak for their sin. He that hateth me hateth my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not had sin, but now have they both seen and hated both me and my Father. Jesus is standing in the shadow of the cross. He's warning of what's coming when the green tree shifts to the dry. But this cometh to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. In their law. Now who's he talking about? He's talking about the world, the cosmos, operating in the professed people of God. He's not talking about people up in Germany. He's not talking about people in India or China or Japan. He's talking about the Jews. They had a law. And this is all happening. This hatred against Christ, his Father, and the followers, which he calls the world. This hatred which he calls the world. All took place that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. They hated me without a cause. But when the Comforter, that's the Holy Spirit, is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me, and ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. Now these words, and you're going to see even more clearly what this world is that he's talking about. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. They're going to disfellowship you. They're going to excommunicate you. This is the world, the cosmos, which is under the power of the prince of the power of the air, that is operating inside the professed people of God. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God service. So this is a very powerful thing. Very powerful deception. Functioning within the professed people of God, the cosmos. Satan functioning within the context of the people of God, which Jesus calls the cosmos, translated the world. And they're going to think they do God's service by killing you. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them, and these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. He's warning them now that these things are going to be happening now that he's gone, especially, and they did happen right away. If they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? So in Psalms 1, in 2 Corinthians 6, 17 and 18, we have the command of God, come out from among them, be ye separate, and touch not the unclean. Clear separation. Psalms 1, we have the separation between the godly and the ungodly. John 15, we have a separation between the world functioning within the professed people of God and the true disciple. Now let's go to another dimension of it in Luke 13. These are all very important concepts, because the conditioning process of Satan is intensifying now, as we had presented so eloquently in our Sabbath school lesson this morning. Luke 13, verse 23 and following. Then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, notice the question, are there going to be few? Is it going to be all that be saved in the professed people of God, or are there going to be few? Strive, agonizo, agonize, to enter in at the strait gate. For many, I say to unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. So what is the point of division here now? The point of division is whether you can actually make it through the straight gate of self-surrender, which requires leaving everything behind in your absolute devotion to Christ. Agonize, Jesus said, to enter in at the straight gate which is so narrow, compressed, is what it means. For many, I say, if you will seek to enter in and shall not be able. When once the master of the house is risen up and hath shut to the door, and you begin to stand without and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. And he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not whence ye are. So, what is Jesus saying? There are many people who are going to try to be saved. They want to be saved. They want to be in heaven. They see this picture of heaven presented in the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. They want to be there. And they say, Lord, Lord, open to us. Let us into heaven. But the test will be whether there was absolute self-surrender going through the straight gate. Many will try to go, but only few will make it. Then shall you begin to say, and here's what the people will say then, we have eaten and drunk in thy presence, and thou hast taught in our streets. We've heard your voice, Christ, in the Sabbath school class, in the sermons, in the books that we've read. We've had your actual presence. But he shall say, I tell you, I know you not whence ye are. Depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Many people are going to be shocked. Most will be shocked to find that they never actually went through the straight gate, never experienced that, which can only come through agonizing, Jesus said. Agonizing to surrender the self to Christ. That's the principle and the issue of the bondage of the will, which lay at the foundation of the Protestant Reformation, which today almost no one knows anymore. Now we live in a humanistic society where the idea is that freedom comes from doing whatever you please instead of doing what God says. The whole idea of crucifixion of self is almost non-existent now, even in the religious world. So there's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you shall see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God and you yourselves thrust out. These people will be outside the holy city. And they will see the faithful inside at the third coming of Christ to this earth. And they shall come from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south and shall sit down in the kingdom of God. Behold, there are last which shall be first and there are first which shall be last. Simply having all the writings at our disposal does not save us, as Paul pointed out in Romans chapter 2. The Jews had the oracles of God, but it didn't save them. They had not learned to surrender to Christ. So now we have the call, come out and be ye separate, touch not the unclean, in 2 Corinthians 6. Then we have the separation between the godly and the ungodly in Psalms 1. We have the separation between the true disciple and the world functioning amongst the professed people of God in John 15. And here in Luke 13, we have the separation that takes place between those who are absolutely surrendered to Christ and those who seek to be surrendered but never actually fully surrender. Now let us look at Matthew 7. Matthew 7, the Sermon on the Mount. The end and conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 7. And let us begin with verse 21. Jesus is wrapping up his great Sermon on the Mount. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Once again, I say to you that this concept of doing God's will and not my will is almost non-existent in our world today. But yet this lies at the foundation of our First Amendment. It was Protestantism that gave us the First Amendment to the Constitution. It was not the concept of everybody just being free to do their own will. And that has led now to the destruction of the Constitution. Verse 21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. So our great goal needs to be to find out what is God's will for my life. Not what do I want to do, but what does God want me to do? Sometimes God asks us to do things that we would rather not do. Look at Jonah. God asked him to go and speak and preach to the wickedest city in the world, Nineveh. As you approach that city, the skins of the people who had been skinned alive were hanging from the walls. The Assyrians were the bloodiest butchers of the ancient world. There were giant pyramids of human skulls that they heaped up of their enemies. They skinned their enemies alive and then hung their skins on the wall. And God said, go preach to that city. Tell them to repent and turn to God. And he went down into the ship and he headed for Tarshish, which is Spain. Farthest area of the civilized world. You get beyond that and you start heading up toward where the tin mines were up in Britain, where apparently Hebrew slaves were shipped after 722 B.C. when the 10 tribes went into captivity, because there's Hebrew place names all through Cornwall and Wales. So he headed for the farthest place, the farthest reaches, the edge of civilization. The ships of Tarshish were around for hundreds and hundreds of years, all through Bible times, and they were well known. And you know the story of Jonah, how he finally asked the sailors to throw him overboard, because he knew that the storm had come because of his failure to do God's will. And then the whale swallowed him. He was in the belly of the whale. And then vomited out on the land. And this time he was ready to go. And he went. And he had the most astounding success of any preacher that we know of in the Bible. The entire capital city of the bloodiest nation in the world, with the skins of its enemies hanging on the wall and pyramids of skulls, repented from the king down to the very bottom of the caste system. He did the will of God, though he didn't want to do it. Sometimes the will of God, oftentimes the will of God, clashes with our will. And that's where crucifixion of self comes in. So, this verse, 7:21, where is the division here? The division is between saying and doing. Because the people who come to Christ and say, Lord, Lord, and they are very vociferous about the Lord. They say amen all the time, perhaps, you know, and they have all the blessings rolling off of their lips, and they have all the religious talk, Lord, Lord. But the Lord says it's the one who does the will. Don't get swept off your feet by Pentecostalism. It's a big force in these last days, and it's gaining momentum now like a big tsunami. So, it's the one who does the will. It may not be as dramatic. It may even involve things that we don't want to do. But it's good discipline for the soul to do things that God asks us to do that we don't want to do. Now let's look at the next verse. So notice the division here now. It's between those who say and those who do. Now verse 22 cuts it even deeper. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Well, there's some doing. Prophesying in the name of Christ, that involves teaching the word, prophesying, doing. So these people present themselves to the Lord as doers of the word. Have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils? You said, Lord, cast out devils in the end of Mark, and we've been doing it. That's pretty dramatic, to cast out devils. And in thy name done many wonderful works. Maybe we've worked for ADRA. Maybe we've helped people overseas. And maybe we did mission work. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. There was something wrong with their works. The devil had inspired them to do works which were not connected with submission to Christ, where Christ got the glory, and which involved self-surrender. I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. So notice how deeply this cuts. I never knew you. In the end, the issue of knowing the Lord lies at the foundation. Every plant that my Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. We heard it in Sabbath school today. Jesus said, and the reins, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, the winds blew. The winds are going to start blowing now. A perfect storm is developing. The things that we have read about at the end times are gathering on the horizon. And beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. That rock is Christ Jesus. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Now I want to examine with you the gathering storm. The storm that is gathering on the horizon as the thunderings are muttering and the lightnings are flashing in the distance, and the clouds are getting dark. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 10. We want to look now at the intermission, the interlude, or the insertion, we might better say, in the midst of the sixth trumpet. The fifth and sixth trumpets deal with the rise and power of Islam, and you need have no doubt what kind of a religion the religion of Islam is. The Word of God has spoken in Revelation chapter 9, and you can look at it right here in verse 11. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. Who is that? That's Satan. That's Lucifer. Let's look at chapter 9, verse 1. The fifth angel sounded, and I saw a great star fall from heaven unto the earth. That's Lucifer falling to the earth. And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, the abyss, abusos. And there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. There came forth out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And then comes a description of the Islamic armies as they went forward to conquer. And the king over them was the angel of the bottomless pit. That's obviously referring back to Revelation 9, verse 1, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. And you have the option to look in your margin, and you can see what it means, what that name means. Abaddon and Apollyon means destroyer. Satan is the king over Islam. Muhammad is not a star that fell from heaven, though that theory is now spreading rapidly around the world due to the writings of one man who, as far as I know, has never spent any time living in a Muslim village. A lot of wishful thinking and a lot of distortion of scripture in his book being sold amongst the professed people of God. But the Word of God is very clear about what kind of religion Islam is. Now, Revelation chapter, that's the fifth trumpet, and then the sixth trumpet is the second development of Islam. And notice, just way of observation here, verse 20 and 21 of Revelation 9, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils, and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. The trumpets are sent like a trumpet warning to repent. And the Islamic armies were sent against Christianity and against the world to warn the people to repent and to turn to God and give up their idolatry. And the Word of God says that they didn't repent. And now comes, and it's something inserted in the sixth trumpet. It's before the seventh trumpet. And let's look at verse 5 of chapter 10. This is the rise of Adventism. The rise of Adventism takes place in the time frame of the Sixth Trumpet. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth, that's Christ, pen of inspiration tells us, lifted up his hand to heaven, swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. The longest time prophecy reaches to 1844, and there's no time prophecies after that. So we can rest on that. That's the sure word of the pen of inspiration. It's not talking about probation closing there. It's talking about the stopping of prophetic time. The longest time prophecy reaches to 1844 and stops. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Now let's look at chapter 11, which talks about the rise of another power. Notice the rise of Adventism in chapter 10, the rise of Jesuitical Communism in chapter 11. And so we'll pick up with verse 3 of chapter 11, and I will give power unto my two witnesses, that's the Old and New Testaments, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, 1,260 days, translated into years, Ezekiel 4:6 and Numbers 14:34, clothed in sackcloth. So why did they prophesy clothed in sackcloth? Because they were being persecuted by Rome. These are the two olive trees. So this is how the olive oil of the Holy Spirit comes into the world through the Word, through the Old and New Testaments, and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. Notice how important this book is that you hold in your hand. The Old and New Testaments are the two candlesticks that are burning before the throne of God. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. That reminds us of the story of when the king who had fallen through the lattice and was doomed to die sent 50 men with a captain to bring Elijah back to punish him for having declared that the king was going to die, and that for telling the king that he should not go to the gods of the heathen. And Elijah said, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from God out of heaven and devour you and your 50. And fire came down from God, devoured the captain and his 50. So the king sent another 50 and another captain. The captain demanded that Elijah come down off the hill where he was sitting. And Elijah said, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and devour you and your 50. And he came down. The third captain, learned from the experience of the first two, was humble and had a spirit of humility, and the Lord said to him, go with him, don't be afraid of him. So that's what it's talking about here. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. Anyone who hurts the word is going to be burned up in the last day. The Bible's very clear. These have power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy. God gave Elijah the key to the elements, the key to the operations of nature, because of his faith. And he came and he spoke to Ahab and warned him that there would be neither dew nor rain, except by my word. God put that power in a man. That's how much he trusted Elijah. He didn't say, oh, maybe I can't trust Elijah. He trusted him. These have power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood. There you have the plagues in Egypt, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. And when they shall be finishing, it's a better translation, Ellen White points that out, when they are finishing their testimony, that is, as they're coming close to 1798, 538 to 1798, the 1260-day year prophecy, as they're finishing their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. What is this beast? It is the French Revolution. The teachings of the French Revolution, which Ellen White says in Education 228, are being disseminated around the world, and they're going to bring the same thing to the world that convulsed France, which was the Reign of Terror. A global reign of terror is going to come directly from the teachings of the French Revolution, which were systematized by Karl Marx in the Communist Manifesto. And these teachings were developed by the Jesuits in Paraguay from 1600 to 1750. And they took Plato's Republic, the principles of communism out of Plato's Republic, and taught them to the Guarani Indians, a 250,000 Guarani Indians, who put them on 31 or 32 reductions and took care of them, clothed them, trained them. They worked hard. All of their income was taken into the central storage house and then distributed from each according to his ability to each according to his need, the principle of Marxism and the principle of Plato's Republic. And the Jesuits wanted to do the same thing here in North America. That was their plan. And if they couldn't do it with the English colonists, they were going to do it with the Indians. So you have such Jesuits as de Smet coming out and all through the West here and working to convert the Indians to try to set up Jesuit reductions here in North America. They had their eye on North America from about 1600 on. And when the Mormons came through, they counseled with de Smet. And de Smet counseled them to go out and found a new nation called Deseret in the desert around the Salt Lake, Great Salt Lake, and to form their own nation, which would be based on the principles of the Jesuit reductions. Well, by 1750, things were happening in Europe, and there was a great call to eliminate Jesuit influence from the governments of Europe. And they called upon the Pope to deal with this. And finally, there was a Pope who was strong enough to do it, the second Clement. I forget what his designation was, what number he was, but Pope Clement finally suppressed the Jesuits forever in a decree in 1773. Well, what happened was that freed up the Jesuits to go into the secular world. And the Jesuits developed the Illuminati. Adam Weishaupt was a Jesuit who taught at the Jesuit School of Ingolstadt, taught canon law there, and he developed the Illuminati. And the memoirs illustrating the history of Jacobinism, the Jacobin Club was present, of course, prominent in the French Revolution in the Reign of Terror. The memoirs illustrating the history of Jacobinism by the Abbé Baruel, which was 2,000 pages long, lay out the plan to take over the world by infiltrating the Illuminati, which was just a front organization for the Jesuits, into all the governments, eat them out from inside out, and have the Jesuits run all the world like a Jesuit reduction. It was the principles of the teachings of the French Revolution. And there was a courier from the Illuminati groups in Germany that was going by horseback to France. He was carrying the plans for the French Revolution. He was struck by lightning, and the local peasants came and found his body, the local residents, and they saw his satchel, and they found what was written there, and they notified the police, who gave the material to the government of Bavaria, which then printed it for all of Europe to see, the plans for the French Revolution. No one took any significant interest. It was too fantastic, kind of like Hitler's Mein Kampf. And so the Illuminati determined that they would never again go under the name Illuminati. They renamed themselves the League of the Just, which ultimately Marx joined. And they proceeded with the French Revolution. And so those teachings of the French Revolution now are disseminated all through America. There's 10,000 Marxist professors in over 400 universities, and those teachings now have spread far and wide. They are the teachings from the bottomless pit that makes war on the Bible. Notice verse 7, "The beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, shall overcome them," that's the Old and New Testaments, "and kill them, and their dead bodies," that is the dead bodies of the Old and New Testaments, "shall lie in the street of that of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt." And that is referring to France. We have that on the sure testimony of the Word of God from the pen of inspiration in Triumph of God's Love or Great Controversy. There's an entire chapter on the French revolution. And that's her exposition now of Revelation 11. So we have now before us an example of what happens when the teachings of the French Revolution take place. There was cannibalism, there was anarchy, there was slaughter. One group one day would be in power, and the next day another group would surface and cut off the heads with the guillotine of all of the ones that had been in power the day before. I have accounts, amazing accounts of that time frame, book after book on the French Revolution. It is very central to the revelation of Jesus Christ in Revelation chapter 11. France was spiritually called Sodom because of its licentiousness. Now I have to ask you the question, what is America becoming like? Is it licentious? You can't even listen to the news anymore. You never want to raise children listening to the news anymore. It is so wicked. And the homosexual community has gained such power and influence, and they're basically ruling California now, especially in the school systems, where they virtually come to the point of almost banning the use of the terms mom and dad, because it is an offense to homosexual marriages where they have two dads or two moms. It is also spiritually called Egypt, which was noted for its atheism. And it's very interesting that Dostoevsky, who was wrote during the time of Ellen White, had very amazing spiritual insights over in Russia. In his dissertation on the Grand Inquisitor in the Brothers Karamazov, where he's describing what the Roman Catholic Church is like and its essential principles, mentions of how many of the Jesuits are virtual atheists. Where also our Lord was crucified. The Jesuits had ruled over France for 150 years before the French Revolution. They were the only ones that flourished, Ellen White said, in that nation. They had driven out the French Huguenots for 300 years, and now just the Jesuits ruled over them, and finally the teachings of Jesuitical communism came, this new power, this new form of satanic power. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves, and they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and so shall send gifts one to another, because these two prophets, the Old and New Testaments, tormented them that dwelt on the earth. And this happened in France in the French Revolution. And after 3 days and a half, 3.5 years, prophetic time, the spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. The teachings of the French Revolution went on. They penetrated into Russia after Marx wrote Das Kapital in 1881. The book made its way past the Russian Tsar's censors. And the censors were there to stop any subversive books. But when they looked at Das Kapital, it was a massive, thick book that was dealing with the capitalism and the economy of England. And they thought it was harmless, so they let it through. And within 10 years, that book was printed by the thousands in Russia. Within 10 years, virtually every student in the universities in Russia was a Marxist. In fact, in 1891, the Pope himself issued an encyclical called Rere Novarum. And in that encyclical, he reproduced virtually almost word for word whole segments out of the Communist Manifesto, out of Das Kapital, actually, instead of the Communist Manifesto, but the same kind of principles of the French teachings of the French Revolution. Now, why am I going into all of this? Because these teachings have lived on, and now America is on the cusp of revolution. And I'll tell you why I believe that. We have a man running for president who has attracted euphoric crowds, who has grown up in the environment of the teachings of the French Revolution. As a boy, he was educated in Roman Catholic schools and Islamic schools in Jakarta in Indonesia. And then he came back to America. Ultimately, he went to Occidental College in Los Angeles, in the suburban area of Los Angeles. I want to bring you a little more definite material on this, because there are some striking parallels He was a young law student, passing his final law exams first in his class. He was a nihilist, taking in the culture that was in the air he breathed all around him. At 23, he was involved in Marxist study groups where he insisted that, quote, no advance could be made until the workers themselves were thoroughly saturated with revolutionary ideas and theoreticians were thoroughly saturated with the habits and tastes and modes of thought of the working classes. I'm not talking about this presidential candidate right here. I'm talking about someone else. The dialogue between theory and practice must be maintained. That's what's called praxis in Marxist terms. Marxists love what's called dialectical praxis. It's taught all through higher education now. It's all through our government. It's all through the churches. What it means, the Jesuits were masters of the dialectic. On the one hand this, on the other hand that. You remember the Pharisees were that way. They loved to look at the thesis, the way things are, and then the antithesis, the exact opposite. Destroy the thesis, destroy the antithesis, and erect a synthesis, a blending of the thesis and antithesis, which becomes the new thesis, which then has its antithesis, and they form a new synthesis. That's why you have this candidate now running for president calling for change, change, change. Marxists love change because they believe that is how history functions. Change based on the Hegelian dialectic. But back to this man that I'm talking about, this young lawyer. So he made his way, establishing contacts, studying and writing, pounding the streets through the working class districts, asking all manner of questions about the cost of living and labor contracts and under what conditions a workman would strike. He was a powerful debater. He asked precise questions and expected precise replies. He seemed to know everything. His calm self-assurance was intimidating as he asked the workers in meetings about their work, the factories, the labor conditions, what interested them most. This is what you call dialoguing to consensus. You get the things that the people are concerned about and you work on that. He was easy to listen to and very convincing. He tramped countless streets, met countless workers, and believed that one must be able to think like a working man, behave like a working man, be a working man. He saw himself as a prophet, another Isaiah. He wrote about complete freedom. He would fight for the working man. He advocated change, great change. After living abroad, he was received back in his country with a thunderous roar of genuine excitement and enthusiasm. His coming was believed to be providential. The crowd spilled into all the streets. The band played. The people shouted. The welcoming speech for him at his arrival declared, quote, we believe that what is needed is not disunity, but the closing of the ranks of the entire democracy, end quote. One of the most brilliant journalists described the young lawyer hero's response the following way. Here he is describing this young lawyer. Quote, there was presented a bright, dazzling, and exotic light which obliterated everything we lived by. Upon us there broke a music which was new. He was carried away on the shoulders of the people. He had come to bring change, great change. His name was Lenin. Lenin, who brought the communist revolution, the teachings of the French Revolution, to Russia. And so today, in America, we have another lawyer. A lawyer who thinks like the people, the bulk of the people in America, who have had their thinking Marxized by the universities, by the churches. The vast clientele of the voting world see in this candidate one of their own, one who thinks like them, with them, in Marxist categories of thought. He's been immersed in the most radical form of Marxism, black power, black liberation theology. And I have a couple of the books by the mentor of the pastor of this candidate, A Black Theology of Liberation by James Cone. James Cone is a professor at Union Theological Seminary, a very liberal seminary in New York. Black Theology and Black Power. Let me give you a little illustration of what this wing of Marxism, of Black Theology, Black Liberation Theology, believes. The quote, this is a quote now from the book by Jonah Goldberg, Liberal Fascism, The Secret History of the American Left. That's talking about the teachings of the French Revolution, from Mussolini to the politics of meaning. Quote, the key to solving the social problems of our age. Now, he has a quote within a quote. The quote within begins with the word key. The quote, key to solving the social problems of our age is to abolish the white race, end quote, writes the whiteness studies scholar and historian Noel Ignatieff. Whiteness studies is a cutting-edge academic discipline. Now, this is Jonah Goldberg writing. His book has just been selling like everything. Whiteness studies is a cutting-edge academic discipline sweeping American higher education. Some 30 universities have whiteness studies departments, but many more schools teach the essentials of whiteness studies in other courses. Now, what are these departments of whiteness studies? They study everything about the white culture and how to destroy it and replace it with Afrocentrism, usually, with some other culture. That's what multiculturalism is all about. To replace the dominant white Anglo-Saxon Protestant culture from which we got the Protestant Reformation and the principles of our republic, to destroy that and replace it with Afrocentrism, other cultural orientations, but generally it's Afrocentrism. This is the Black Liberation Theology of this candidate's pastor, Jeremiah Wright, a foremost disciple of James Cone, Charles A. Briggs, distinguished professor of systematic theology at Union Theological Seminary in New York. And here's what Cone writes in A Black Theology of Liberation, which is this book here. Incidentally, his books are published by the Mary Knollers, who are an order in the Roman Catholic Church. The goal of Black theology is the destruction of everything white so that blacks can be liberated from alien gods. And I'll tell you what that means. That means the destruction of the Protestant Reformation. That means the destruction of Adventism, because Adventism emerged out of a white background. And this is the most radical, racist, Marxist orientation that there is in the world. And this candidate sat under a mentor, Jeremiah Wright, who was mentored by James Cone, who wrote these words. For 20 years, this candidate sat under him as his spiritual advisor. He said, he's been my spiritual advisor and my mentor. So, this candidate has been immersed in the most radical form of Marxism, Black Power, Black Liberation Theology, a theology that has brought revolution in Latin America, in Nicaragua. It was liberation theology that took over. The Jesuits ran the country. El Salvador, same thing. And this liberation theology is rife at Andrews University. The chaplain of the student body there is a clear advocate of principles of liberation theology. I analyzed it in a few papers back when we discussed how the older elders at the Pioneer Memorial Church say, I can't recognize my church anymore. This new generation, they don't even look like Christians, let alone Adventists. And this man responded that it's the experience of the people that matters. He doesn't emphasize the word of God like Protestants. The experience of the people, this is what the Jesuits said. And that this generation is the generation that's going to go into heaven. This is the generation that's going to go through. This is the Acts 2 generation. And the old elders that are questioning them, they're obviously not going to be going to heaven. It was an article in the Union paper. I just stated it as it was. He used words to kind of soften it down, but that's the principle of what he stated. So, these revolutions in inter-America, in Latin America have been orchestrated by the Jesuits. It's the teachings of the French Revolution. So this candidate has been immersed in this Jesuit liberation theology for 20 years. He's a smooth, sure-footed Marxist constitutional law professor. I took apart his chapter, bit by bit, in his book, one of his autobiographies, this candidate. It's the Jesuit dialectic all the way through. It's the Hegelian dialectic. He says, on the one hand, there's a strict constructionist. On the other hand, those who believe that the Constitution is an evolving document. And I would shred, in the end, although I have sympathy for both views, I shred both positions, and I create a new metaphor. And I say, this candidate says, I say that the Constitution is all about a conversation to be had. And the conversation to be had, we are told how to have this conversation by the Constitution. And what's he doing? He is doing exactly what Lenin and these other men did in the Soviet Union. They had all these little Soviets where they held conversations with the people. What do you think about your work? What do you think about the factories? What are your dissatisfactions? And they would dialogue to consensus. They would break down the old principles of authority from God and substitute the authority of the commune. That's what basic to the French Revolution. And this man, this Marxist constitutional law professor, beat the streets just like Lenin, only in Chicago. He's a senator with the most radical left-wing voting record of all the senators. He's now in the lead in the polls to be the next U.S. president. He's been catapulted out of virtual obscurity into a run for the presidency. When you see that, and when you see the fawning of the media, and no unbiased biography of him speak of in the major book chains, other than his own autobiography. I did find a biography by Mendel, which is largely favorable to him, but it reveals a lot of things. You may know that powerful forces are interested in using him to accomplish their purpose. They love to handpick their men out of obscurity and rapidly catapult them into power before anyone can find out what they really believe. And the radical left-wing website MoveOn.org is continually raising hundreds of millions of dollars to fund his bid for the White House. He has at his disposal many, 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 many times the amount of money that his Republican opponent has. He has declared that his spiritual advisor, his spiritual mentor, is his erstwhile pastor, Jeremiah Wright, pastor of an 8,000-member church, pastor who most closely follows the Black Power, Black Liberation theology of the ultra-radical Professor James Cone, who wrote, "The goal of black theology is the destruction of everything white, so that blacks can be liberated from alien gods." The public has wrestled with this. What does it mean that this is a new thing, kind of catchy? This is a candidate for the presidency who for 20 years has had this rabid, radical, black power, black liberation theology pastor as his own acknowledged spiritual advisor and spiritual mentor. That's what the words that this man used about his pastor. A mentor is one to whom a spirit person submits his spiritual life and judgment. It's a principle right out of Jesuitism. The Jesuits do this. The Bible says, "He that walketh with wise men shall be wise, but a companion of fools shall be destroyed." Proverbs 13:20. In other words, the people that you associate with have a direct and powerful bearing upon you, your judgment, and your destiny. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Now, this man used marijuana, snorted cocaine. He and his buddies would go and stamp out their cigarettes in the carpet of the hallway of the dorm and ramp up their music until the walls just shook. And he said they did this to test the limits of bourgeois society. What is that word, bourgeois? That was a word that Marx used all the time in the Communist Manifesto. But he is using the Gramsci-style approach, where you never show an inappropriate face. You work within the institutions. He's following what a German follower of Gramsci said. It's going to be a long march through the institutions of the West for Marxism to take over. And this candidate used the very term, the long march, in his great speech on race. So this man, this candidate growing up, his hero was Malcolm X. And he is a deep believer in the Hegelian dialectic. In fact, in his chapter on the U.S. Constitution, he has multiple levels of dialectical going on, where he destroys one thesis and the antithesis and erects a synthesis off of multi-tiered thesis and antithesis, which is very, very interesting. He absolutely loves the way Marxism thinks. There's also something very interesting, and that is that it has long been known that when Marxism would take over in America, it would probably use Lincoln as one of its heroes to gain sympathy with the masses. And this man likens himself to Lincoln over and over again, another Illinois lawyer. And so we are facing the real prospect of America becoming America with a K, A-M-E-R-I-K-A. Gramsci said that Marxism would create in the West its own original culture, destroying bourgeois myths and prejudices. You see this happening every day on the news. What are some of those bourgeois myths? Bourgeois meaning Protestant, white, middle class? Well, the Protestants haven't been happy about homosexuality, so it gets hammered every day, destroying the bourgeois myths, making way for homosexuals, making way for all of this deviation, until we get to the point where we go into town and we look around and we say, are we still in America? It is a generation, as one attorney friend recently said to me, with no root. The vast majority of Americans now have been Marxized in the inner man. And this is what Gramsci, the Italian communist theorist, said. You cannot approach it like Lenin did, talking about the dictatorship of the proletariat. You have to Marxize the inner man. You have to get it so the rank and file in the population start thinking along Marxist concepts of thought. This is where the dialectical praxis comes in all of these government programs. Even in the church and in academia especially, the man who really ferreted this all out, read hundreds and hundreds of books. It was over 600 books that helped him to understand why he almost lost his faith in a Christian college. It was the dialectical praxis that was at work. So what are we facing? At the same time all of this is happening, Barclays Bank, one of the biggest banks in the world. You go all over the world, Africa, and everywhere you find Barclays. Barclays warns of a financial storm as the Federal Reserve's credibility crumbles. That's from the Telegraph in the UK. The Royal Bank of Scotland has issued a global stock and credit crash alert. They're predicting global crash. Morgan Stanley has joined in. And Fortis, big banking firm in the Netherlands, likewise, are warning that there is a global crash coming, perhaps within the next 3 months. What happened in Germany? Hyperinflation. That's what America is facing now because of the policies of the Fed. The Federal Reserve has not paid attention to the problem of inflation, and the American dollar has plummeted to alarming lack of value now. A quarter from pre-1964 mints in America, a quarter, like what you put in a machine, now is worth $2.80. And silver is just shy of $1,000 an ounce. I mean, gold is shy of $1,000 an ounce, $900 and some an ounce, and silver is $18.24, the last I checked, $18.24 an ounce. So we are facing a global financial situation like the 1930s. And the black intellectual Thomas Sowell, who is highly respected on every side of the issue that he writes about, and who has studied these things for decades, warns that if this candidate becomes president, it will be a disaster. because he says his policies are the same policies in foreign affairs that were used in the 1930s that brought on World War II eventually, and his domestic policies are those of the 1960s that brought America to the point where its cities were burning as rioting took place throughout the cities. So this is a storm that I see coming on the horizon, a storm that was foretold by the pen of inspiration. Perhaps providence will intervene and give us a little more time, but we are seeing in nature new developments. Terrible floods, 1.3 billion maybe I better not give you a statistic on it. I'll just say vast amounts of farmland underwater in the breadbasket of America. Vast amounts of farmland destroyed by flooding. They had 10 to 12 inches of rain in minutes out in that area in the Midwest. 1,700 forest fires burning in California, as we heard in Sabbath school. Nature is being distorted now. And terrific storms, terrific hurricanes, terrific tornadoes going through cities now, small cities, destroying hundreds of homes. It is exactly what the pen of inspiration told us would happen as the Spirit of God is withdrawn from the earth. More and more devastation will take place until eventually seeds will no longer germinate and the seeds will lie rotten in the clods, the Old Testament says. And so, when we see all this happening, we are to look up and realize that our redemption draweth nigh. And we are to realize the importance of the counsel that we have to come out from among them and be ye separate. We are on the train station, as it were, waiting for the express to come through to take us to heaven. And the Lord says that if we are to go to heaven, we have to be a peculiar people. We have to be a separate people. In all these areas that we studied today, we have to show our loyalty and be loyal in our heart of hearts, in absolute self-surrender to Christ, so that we will be ready to meet Him in peace when He comes. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have spent just a few minutes today, a few fleeting minutes, in contemplating your word. All the different categories that your word tells us of separation between the godly and the ungodly, and the worldly influence among the professed people of God, and the true disciple, and those who are fully surrendered, and those who aren't, and those who say, and those who do, and those who do from wrong motives, and who are not known by thee. But may we be known by Thee, may we be planted by Christ, may we listen to the voice of the Father and the Holy Spirit and Christ in our hearts, and be truly planted in the kingdom of God, nurtured and brought to fruitfulness by the showers of the Holy Spirit in our heart. May that word germinate and grow into a great tree in our life, and may we be ready for the express, as it were, when Jesus comes the second time. What a powerful, awesome event that will be, and may we be ready and waiting for Him is our prayer in Jesus' name, and for His sake, amen.
Amen.